Okay, so we'll try to go into some more useful things today other than just seeing how IDL works. And I'm going to assume that you remember what we said last time, and I'm going to also assume that you know about programming in general. I don't care about which language you know, just some language. So things, the new things that I'm going to show you, I'm going to assume that you will that you have the basic knowledge to follow up. And I'm also going to show you a lot of new things today. So don't worry about remembering them all by heart, and also don't expect from me to tell you everything, all the syntax and all possible options, but I will just give you the clues on how you can how to start the basic things, and then you can refine based on your needs and also based on this book. Don't forget about this book. It's still here if you want to rotate it around. That has all the syntax needed. So, before starting, is there anybody who has any questions concerning the previous time? Something that you want me to repeat? Yes?
Yes.
Okay, so now there are two important things that we need to use IDL for. One is read some data and do something with it, and one save that some data. So I'm going to discuss only about reading and writing ASCII files and reading and writing NetCDF files. And for anything else, the way I will present you for NetCDF works identically for HDF, but not for writing HDF. You can only read HDF files the way I will show you. Is everybody familiar with NetCDF? Yes? No? Yes? Okay, good. So I'm going to assume that you know the structure of an IDL file. And when I say attribute and variable and naming things, I will assume that you know it unless you interrupt me, okay? But let's start from the easy things first. Reading files, ASCII files, there are three different ways to do it. For IDL, it's important to know that you cannot read from an ASCII file and assign what you read into a part of an array. You only have, when you read something, you have to read the full array that you are assigning the data to. And then you can play with it. So let's see how this works. And I want you to focus on this program here, okay? This is a whole subroutine that is, this is not part of the code. So I want you to focus into this subroutine first. Okay, don't look anything else on the screen, only this subroutine. So this is a subroutine that says, that writes a file. I gave it a name, and it reads from the input some days. This is what I want to have in my x-axis. This will be an array of numbers, which are the days. And then it also reads some data, and also reads the titles of this data. And in order to see this, I created here. Yes. So this part here is where it creates the data I will give into the subroutine that I will write. I will save something. So I say I will have 30,000 lines in my code with whatever I want to write. I just create an array of integers, and I save it in the days in array. Okay, this, I remind you, creates an array from 0 to 29999, and then by adding 1, I make that starting from 1, just to confuse you a bit. Then I create some artificial data. This function with the seed is it creates just random numbers from 0 to 1, just for our case, and I will have 5 columns and 30,000 lines into my file. I just create some data. In your case, this data exists. You have it and you have some number there. And then I create some titles. This is the days, the column one, and then the five next columns is title one, title two, title three, title four, etc. Now, this part I explained it last time. And I just want you to go here for to remind you this and just to go into the ideal mood again. So this thing here creates an array of integers from 0 to 4. Adding the string, no. Then I add 1, so it goes from 1 to 4 to 5. Okay? And then I create this string up to here. So instead of having an integer, I now have a string that is 1 to 5, so just some text. And then I trim this string from both sides to remove blank spaces. Okay? So this thing just creates the numbers 1 to 5, and this is a string. No spaces left or right. Is this clear? Yes. Perfect. So the titles in array has 6 strings. There is title 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then by using the line I have commented out, by using this line, I say, use the function I have on top, put the days I have created, put the data I have created, and use these titles as well. Okay? And this is a very generic routine, and then I can have it here. So I open the file with open write. You can open the file with open read. I assign a unit number. This thing doesn't exist, and this is something very dynamic in IDL that is very nice to do. So you can assign there a number and then open it here, just like Fortran. You say open unit number file and forget the rest. So, and then you have assigned the unit number. If you do it though like this, you assign something that has no value, and then you say slash get logical unit number. This is the LUN stand for. So IDL takes the first available number there, and you don't have to worry about numbering. You just have to worry about giving a proper name here. And then the trick is that you don't close the file with saving close, but you say free logical unit number and whatever you have named your variable here. And IDL like this can open any unit from number 10 to number 99. So you can open at the same time 89 different files without closing them, and IDL knows how to handle it. And then printf means print in the file of that unit the titles. So it just takes the array of the titles and prints it. And then it's right exactly like Fortran. And again, exactly like Fortran for all the elements that I have in the days, minus 1 because I go from 0 to, the indexing starts from 0, print in this logical unit number the days and the data. And I say print 1 day out of the 30,000 per line, and print all data per day for this line. Okay, identical with Fortran. It's, in Fortran you might have to put an internal loop here. In any case, it's nothing new other than the syntax, okay? Good. Reading this file, writing the file, the ASCII file is very easy. Reading the file has 3 different options. So we just focus here. This line here reads the number of lines. You can assign it, you can say anything you want. If you read this, if you use the file lines function that reads how many lines the file has, be careful that if there are blank lines at the end of your data, it will count them. So make sure that your data ends where the file ends, really. Then you create the array days, you create the array data, you create by knowing the size, and assigning this funny thing. So in IDL, there is there are several parameters, variables, that start with exclamation mark. These are internal parameters that handle several things. They handle some default values. For example, here, this thing is the value floating point, not a number. And it can also have infinity. So you can really play with these numbers directly. And there are also parameters that, for example, the exclamation mark peak, which comes from plot, that handles the default plotting parameters. And there are several others. I'm not going to go into them, but another very useful is the parameter pi and the parameter dpi, which is single precision and double precision of the 3.14 number. So there are some, you will start using them from time to time. And in plotting, I will show you that this also handles the amount of plots you can have in a single page. So I just create the arrays that they are going to be read by and giving them some not a number values. I also create this array data all, which has one extra that will include both the days and the data. So the file, yeah, that's a good idea to show you the file. So the file looks like this, okay? Days, the five titles, and then the number of days, and it goes down to 30,000 and five columns with numbers. So this is what we want to read. So this is the file we want to read. And so I create an array that has six columns and all the lines. I open for reading, with the logical unit number trick, I read the titles, I read the data, I close the file, that's it. And the whole file is being read because I have assigned the proper dimensions. This is the fastest way you can read an ASCII file in IDEO. And the performance in reading the way that I will show you later is degrading, but sometimes you just have to do it. Okay, so by reading this, first of all, I have assigned titles that is equal to an empty string. By default, for IDL, everything is a floating point number. So if you go here and try to read the titles without having assigned what it is, then it tries to read a floating point and it fails. So you have to say titles equals to something just to define it. And this is the only time that IDL really remembers what your variable was. Because if you go and say, if you have an array B equals 0.0, you have an array like this, and then you go say C equals 3, B equals 3, then it's not like Fortran that you will create an array of three elements, all of them equal to 3. You will create a floating point equal to 3. So in this case, it's the only exception. By doing this, IDL knows. And then by reading this, it reads depending on how much you have created here. So, and then after you read it, you assign the data all column 0, all points into the days. And since this is a floating point number by default, I take the integer of it. I can use floor, I can use sale, which is from ceiling. I can use round, any function, either way, this is an integer. And with reform, I just eliminate this dimension of 1. And then I assign the data, whatever I read, from 1 to 5, which means from 1 to 5, comma star, all the lines. Assigning to data that has a dimension of 5, comma n lines. Okay? No questions? No. Yes. Go ahead.
You declare n lines, 30,000.
Yes.
It is necessary to append uppercase L for long integer?
This will happen automatically here. So if the number is above 32,500, whatever is the exact number, I think that file lines will automatically give you long integer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, the default doesn't kick in.
So, the default is long integer in these functions.
Okay.
But if you go.
So when you add one, when you go in the loop, one, it shouldn't be declared long.
So here.
Yes.
Doing this.
Yes.
Is safer.
Okay, and in the loop, when you increase by one, you know the limit.
Yes.
You don't have to declare 0L and 1L, like long.
Here there is
sometimes
no loop here.
Sometimes I get errors.
Yes,
on the
if the loop goes above the limit of the single precision integers, then the moment it exceeds the number, it goes to minus one.
Yeah.
No, minus some random number.
Yeah.
You have to worry about that, yes. But when. This is when you assign numbers yourself. If you try to keep the numbers you assign yourself to the minimum by using functions, they know how to deal with it. So they will assign it a long integer.
For the loop?
For everything.
For everything.
Whatever this function will return you, even if it's the number one or the number 25 million in an integer, it will be long.
Okay.
If the first column there had been strings instead of integers,
That's later. So, that's a good point to tell you now. That by this way, I read the data all, and everything is a floating point, and there is nothing I can do about it. Now, the second way to read. You see the call is identical. I just changed the name of the function. The second way to read it is this. I read the lines, I create the days the same way, I set day to equal zero, just to say this is an integer. I create the data that I say is 5, comma, the number of lines. I create the data day, which is an array of five. Why do I do that? Yes. So I create the array data day, which will include all data for a single day. You'll see why. And then I set the titles to be a string. So forget for a minute this. Let's see what we are doing. Open the file, read the titles, and for all the lines, read, you see now we're having a for loop here. Read the number of lines for all the lines, the logical unit number, comma day that I have assigned it an integer, comma data day that I have assigned it all the data for a single line, and that's it. So I just read the single line into a do loop. Then I assign to the days the value of day, which is an integer already, because I forced it to be. I assign the data that I read for the day. I assign it in this data thing, which is from 5 to n lines. So for all 5 things that I read, for this particular line. And then I close the loop and go back for the next line. So is this clear? This way, you read line by line, not the whole thing, but you can automatically assign different things. So this can be a string. Okay? Two things. One, this makes IDL slow. Try to avoid for loops like the plug. I'm serious. It makes IDL very, very slow. especially if they are very big loops or nested loops. Number two, here I do not read the data star comma I. I read something as a whole, because IDL cannot handle this as an input from reading a file. It has to happen in a second step. Okay? And the third way to do it, I'm not going to, I don't know how much time I want to lose here with the clock. Not much. So I will just give you the way this thing works, and then maybe if we have time, we can discuss it later. But this is my favorite way to read in IDL. So again, we have the same interface for reading. We assign some names. Instead of reading the titles, I could read the titles, okay, in the first place. I could read the titles, but I just didn't want to mess with this for now. So I just assigned the titles instead of reading them. And then I create a template about this file. The way I create this template is a bit strange, so I'm not going to show this to you now unless you are really interested in it. So this is how I create my template. Forget about this part. Just remember that this is a template of reading the file. So I say, all the data I want equals to this internal function of IDL, read ASCII. This is the file name, and this is the template. So I don't open the file. I don't close the file. I don't read anything. Everything happens in a single line. And it stores all the information that are in this file, depending on what the template was saying, into this structure. It's not an array anymore. And then I can assign that the days equals data all dot days, which means that this structure is having one of the elements of the structure is called days, so I can use it like this. And then the data is an array, data all dot title, title one, title two, title three, and this is an array of my data. And then, so this has two advantages. One is the advantage that, well, has quite a few advantages. One is that you can define where your data starts. So you can say my data is not starting at line zero. My data starts at line one. Second, you can say what kind of things you are reading. So I can say that the first one is a long integer, and then the next five are floating points. Then I can also say assign what the delimiter is. If you have a space here, it's easy to read it with any of the ways I showed you. If your delimiter is something like the number 25 for some reason, the only way to do it is to really use this reading and assign that the delimiter is 25. You can assign what you can have missing values, and then you can say what value the missing values will take. You can have symbols in between, comments in between the file, and then you can tell that if some line starts with a hash, that will be a comment, so skip it. This is the most powerful way to do it, but the slowest. Still, I use this, and I'm not going to go into the templates. Template reading, because I don't know how often you read ASCII files, but if we have time at the end, we can go for that for the people that are really interested. It's not very complicated, but it will take us another 10 minutes that I want to avoid.
Costas?
Yes.
I think you should also mention that with Green app, you can specify a format.
Right. Yes. Thank you.
And also, the first line you have there is very interesting.
This one?
ASCII template. So
this
if
one.
You have a file, and with some random format, you do ASCII template, and you can specify the
That's
template.
The part I want to skip now for the interest of time. But
no.
If people are interested on how you create the templates, yes. This is the line that does it. And what Bastian said, which is really useful, and I don't know why I forgot it, is that both for the printf and for the readf commands, you can specify the format exactly as in Fortran. So if you want to print something formatted, or if you want to read something formatted, you can say format equals, and in the parentheses you write whatever you write in Fortran, identical. Okay? I'm going to show you how I create the plots. There are several other ways to do it, and but having something that is ready and functioning and quite a bit customizable can be useful. So for plotting something quickly, you can do it in a couple of lines. And of course, all the functions that I will show you here, I can share them with anybody, and I'm ready to even customize them for you. That can be useful for me as well. Or I'm pretty sure that you will be able to change things there. So let's say you have some global field that we want to plot. For example, temperature. And we have, I'm going to discuss about the model E files because these are the ones that I am familiar with. But this is the way I'm doing it will almost certainly work for any other NetCDF files. So first of all, this to remind you is that it compiles this file. And I'll go into this file in a minute. And it's a generic file that I created just for the purposes of this meeting here. So I set this file type that it will be an AIJL file, and for the Model E people, this makes perfect sense. And then the variable will be the temperature, and I create here the file name. So the file name is something, and this is the way I concatenate strings instead of Fortran, that is the two slashes. And then I say plot this from this file name, this variable. That's it. So if you are having this thing, including that plot, you only have to set these two, and then you have a plot in a PostScript file. Now the PostScript file will be called like this.eps. Okay, it cannot be simpler than that. So let's see though what's in this plot latlon file. Please don't go for, too fast. This contains a lot of new things that I'm not going to go very deep. First of all, I compile my generic plotting routine that we will also go through it. This is the routine that does all the work. What happens here is that I read the file, I print what I'm going to do, I create my data, I manipulate my data a bit, and then I plot it. Okay? So, where to start? Okay, forget the reading for a minute. I don't want to go into that yet. So the file ends here. Reading, printing some messages, manipulating, plotting. The easiest thing to do, let me show you also results, right? It's more fun. Okay, so if I run my do plot function, it fails, we go to some stupid thing. So what happens here is that it opens the files, it says I will plot layer temperature, the units will be Kelvin. Oh yeah, yeah, a little bit sigma. Tells me, I'm reading this file, I will plot layer temperature because it found it in the file name, I will plot in Kelvin, it found it in the file name, this is the, these are the sizes of my arrays, and then that's it, and here's the plot. Okay, and remember that in order to create this, the only thing you change, you have to do is here. Tell me some other variable in AIJL. I've set it to zero for by default, but you can do it. So tell me variable. AIJL.
T-surf.
T?
T.
T-surf. Is it AIJ? So it just plotted surface air temperature the way it found it in the long name, units Celsius. Okay. So let's go play with it a bit. The whole trick is, forget this part, is that I am using the plot ij function that is doing all the plotting thing, every little detail. So I just give the data that I need to plot, that I read from the file, and here's the zero, which means surface, and then it selects several default values. So I decided that in the files that you are going to read, the longitudes will start from minus 180 and they will end in plus 180. And the latitudes start from minus 90 and end in plus 90. If this is not the case, you can give the longitudes and latitudes, you can provide them to the subroutine. So you can say, This is the only thing that this subroutine is needing. Everything else comes like this. So you can say longitudes, latitudes are like that, and this is the value. So if you have a file that starts from zero and goes to 360 degrees in longitude, then you can do it like this. And like that, you can also create zoom plots. So let's see how to do it, how this is working. If we set here the line that the cursor is, I create a mask for the longitudes. And I say where the longitudes are greater than minus 20 and where the longitudes are also lower than 50, count how many they are. And then this is a comment. So then if the count is zero, then stop because something funny happened. For the latitudes, we go from plus 30 to plus 70. And if the count is zero, then we couldn't find any latitude, so something happened. And then I also mask the data, because in Model E, we have the missing data is minus 10 to the 30. So when I say that when the data is lower than minus 10 to the 29, consider it missing. And when there is some missing data, so when the count, remember I overwrite always this count, okay? You don't need it after the test. So when if the count is greater than zero, then for this data that we are going to plot, the, only in the, that the mask succeeded, then set this to a value double precision, not a number, instead of minus 1 to the 30. So not a number will be handled properly in plotting. So what happens here? We have a mask for longitudes, for latitudes, and for the data. And I go here, and I no, for the data we don't need it anymore. We already used it. So we have a mask for longitude and latitude. So I say plot the data, longitude mask, latitude mask. These are arrays, okay? And the longitudes are from the whole set of the longitudes we have read here. It is take only the masked ones, and for the latitudes the same. And what happens? Is this. And you see some white space around? This is on purpose because you say, because the longitudes and latitudes are the middle of the boxes. Yeah. And then because of the interpolation, the edge of it is having no data to the other side, so it cannot interpolate. But you can avoid that as well because I've set a flag here that is called limit center. Oops. Yeah. And it just changes the scale. Picks the middle of the boxes as the edge of the plot, and you have a very nice plot here.
Where did you put it again, the limit center thing? Was it a flag?
Just a flag, slash limit center.
Oh, okay.
And this is identical by saying limit flag equals 1. Okay, any questions here? I'm not expecting you to know how this plot was made yet. We will do that in a minute. But I just want you to know the logic of it. How you can have a function that is calling is by using different options can have different behavior, and how you can manipulate the data so you read the whole set and then you pick the part you want. And by the way, down here it's not visible, but we will see it later in the PostScript file. No, let's do it now. So I told you that the last time. That plotting on the screen and plotting on a file is looks very different. So we can have, I can set these to flag, these three things here. So I create a file name. I say if you find this file name, overwrite it, and the type is EPS. I can also set a title for the plot because right here it says no title set. So I can set the title, or I can set the units. So what happens is that now it says saving file tserf.eps. And this file this file will come up and you will see it. The, I also have a flag. So, oh, thing number one, it looks so much better because I have created these plots in order to print in files. The other thing is this, that it wasn't visible before. It also provides you some statistics here, like the minimum throughout the domain, the maximum, the sum, the non-weighted mean, the non-weight, the median, well, you cannot weight it that, weight that, I guess, and the area-weighted mean. And so, of course, you can play around it. Yes?
So can you do the, like, a block instead of, a, like, a smooth out the order line?
Yes, you can do that. You play with the... It depends on which plotting function you use,
mm-hmm.
but you can do it.
Is there a built-in ideal function that does that, or are you saying in this, in some of the programs that you've made?
I always interpolate.
Yeah.
But I think you have to do it with polyfill.
Yeah, but you'd have to build up something.
Of course, even this is very built up.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But you can get close to that with contour, you can go closer than you can. It would take a lot more work to use polyfill to assist than to use contour to do something like this, but in terms of
I do that with contour.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
But for non-interpolated, I don't remember. I used it a couple of times, but with some other tools, so
mm-hmm.
I don't remember how to do it. Anyway, but yes, of course you can do it. And the other thing, just to whet your appetite a bit more, is that I enabled the slash countries thing. Remember, this is a plot that the function, the plot ij that I created. So it has the flags and the capabilities that I was interested in. So the countries will print the countries' borders, and the stations will print some stations that I have not enabled here. There you go. So it has countries, and it also has some places that it gives the names. It's where I've lived in my life. And so you can, so in for your purposes, you might want to do something else. So you might want to eliminate a box here that is kind of out of bounds compared to the Mediterranean, so you can just manipulate the data furthermore to create it, or you can create, you can have a different color bar. Yeah, let's do that. Yeah, we'll do it later. So we can, you can have a different color bar, for example, saying around zero. So with this, this is for plotting differences for in general. So I create a color bar centered to zero, and the left and the right sides are equal, and it's cold colors below zero, warm colors above zero, and there you go. So this is another option that I like. I always use mainly for differences. But anyway, I'll show you the plot, how it works in a little while, how this plot IJ is really working. And then you will be able to do your own changes anytime you want. But I also want to go into, before going there, I want to go into the reading part. First of all, since everybody is familiar with NetCDF here, oops. these are the netcdf functions that IDL accepts. If you know Fortran, if you know some other package that handles netcdf, maybe with a small difference in the before the underscore sign symbol, everything else should really be should look very familiar. So in general, the syntax is identical. You just have to change a little bit the name. Everything starts with netcdf underscore, and then I'm pretty sure you've seen several of these. So this is how you handle a netcdf in IDL as well. But I don't like all this thing. It's too complicated for the day-to-day operations, and I really wanted to have something way easier to read. And that is, I created an interface that masks everything here and has some more intuitive ways to create files and to primarily to read files, but it can also create files. So I'm not going to go into these details. And the thing is that I created that with some the object-oriented techniques of IDL. I'm not going to discuss what an object is. If you know it, it will be very useful. If you don't, after we finish, I can explain you how this thing works. I can tell you some things about object-oriented programming. So just take for granted for now, if you know object-oriented, that's fine. If you don't, take for granted that object is one extra thing like these ones. Like you have in mind an array or a structure that is a collection of things, object is again a collection of things, but is something much more dynamic. And so just think of object like a structure for now, and or like an array, whatever feels better for you. But I'm not going to go into that. It has a little bit different syntax, but it's not complicated at all, and you will see that it is extremely flexible. So, instead of opening the file, instead of saying open my netcdf file, I say create an object, a new object, that is input output netcdf. This is the object I created, and this is the file name. And I also set the flag quiet just to avoid to not make it verbose. So what this line does is that this line does several things. Number one, opens the file. Well, of course, it checks whether it exists. It opens the file. It assumes that you will access this file in a number of ways. And this number of ways is defined in the documentation of this object. So you can get the dimensions, a dimension, which is that you will provide. You can get the global attribute that you will ask. You can get the attributes of a given variable. You can get the number of attributes of a given variable. You have some things to do. But these namings are way more intuitive compared to the NCDF var get and things like this. And also, these are extremely flexible because you can work with them in a very dynamic way. So the syntax, so after creating an object, here, you access the properties of the object by using the arrow, not the equal sign or something like that. So if you want to take the variable called variable, which is given here, in our case it is tserf. So if you want to get the variable tserf from the file, you say this, from the object get the variable tserf. And you save it to the object of the variable. What is nice here now, which is even more interesting, is that this object this object here knows everything about the tserf. It knows the long name, it knows the short name, it knows the units, it has already applied the unit conversion factor to the data, So if you have optical depth, for example, saved in the file name, in the file, an SDF file, there is a factor 10 to the minus 4 in the units. So this 10 to the minus 4 is already applied to the data, so you can use the data directly. So in this object variable, you have tserf and all information you need in just a single line. So you can get the long name of this by saying, from the object, get the long name. And don't forget the parentheses. You can get the units by saying, from the object, get the units. You can say, get the data, that is whatever you want to plot. From the object, get the data. And this includes the factor that some units have. You can also get the longitudes from the object. So this set here takes everything for tserf. You also want the variable longitudes from the file. So you say, from the object file, get the variable longitude, and I include all of this in the parentheses, and from that, and this is an object here, and then from that object in the parentheses, get the data. So I just do it in a single line. It is practically replacing this line with that, this and that, I just merge them together. I do the same for the latitudes, and then I close the file. So in this set, I have read all the information I need in order to plot something. And if you're interested in working in understanding really the internal structure of all this, I'm happy to tell you about that at the end, okay? And I will assume that you know some object programming there. Yes?
Okay, just a simple question about this. So you use arrows here, so maybe that's because all objects are treated as pointers?
No, objects are treated as structures. But
if you have pointer to structure, that's how you structure.
You don't use the, for the pointers, you don't use arrows, you use equal sign. So for the pointers, if you use the equal sign to a pointer, it means that you are handling the pointer itself.
Yeah.
If you use star and the pointer variable name, you treat the pointer that the thing, whatever this is, that the pointer points to.
Yeah, but the same thing in C. But if you extract something from data structure, but from structure, then you use arrow.
In the pointer, you mean?
If a pointer to the structure, it's easier. To extract something from the structure, you use arrow.
Okay, no, it's not the same here. Here, the arrow means that you want to call the method with that name from the object. So this arrow means call that method.
Okay, so in object, you don't have like pieces of data, you only call methods, or you can also.
The objects in IDL, and we go into too many details now, all objects have methods and, what's the word, parameters? Not parameters.
Attributes.
Yes. They have methods and attributes. In IDL, all object attributes are encapsulated.
So you cannot
access them. There is no way.
So you only see
methods. And the way to access a method of the model of an object is the arrow.
Okay. Thanks.
And you cannot encapsulate methods. All of them are public. Yes?
So data to plot, lons and lats, those are not objects, right? You've extracted.
No. The moment I say get data, I extract.
Yeah. So it's just a floating array.
Exactly.
But objects.
So it depends. Every time I extract something from an object from an object variable, the result is not an object.
Yeah.
So depending on what I extracted, the output will be different. So if I extract the long name, this is a string.
Yeah.
If I extract the longitudes data, this is a one dimensional array. If I extract the data here, this is a three-dimensional array.
Yeah.
Well, it's a two-dimensional array because I used the AIJ file.
But object var actually is an object?
Object var is an object, yes.
Yeah. Extracted from the data.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So I know that this object idea is complicated, but I want you to to know that by using this thing, and of course I'm going to share this with anybody that is interested, by using this, you have read the variable you wanted from the file, and you have already manipulated in a way that is most likely desirable. And although I had in mind the model E output, this way of reading works for all NetCDF files. I have not met any NetCDF file yet that is not working. What will not work is that if there is no long name, this thing will return no long name, of course. And if there are no units, if there is no units attribute in the file in a variable, then it will make no calculations, it will just return the data, yes.
So I imagine it would be easy to generalize this so that when you ask for a particular variable, you check what the names of the dimensions are for that variable. So if there were a file which had dimensions named longitude and latitude instead of mon and lat, your program would not show code.
So here, if you say longitude and latitude, it will work. Because these are variables as well. The name of the dimensions, I don't care about the name of the dimensions. The object will take the data, it will see which dimensions are linked with that variable, and will take them no matter the naming of them. I mean, I'm not using here any information of how the dimensions are being called.
No, but usually the convention is the coordinate variable
Okay, that's.
So if the dimension
yeah.
were longitude in the file, then the name of the corresponding coordinate axis variable would also be.
Okay, now I see what you mean. So you say that when I read this here, what you suggest is that when I read this, there is no point in naming these two here. I just have to say, get me the dimensions of that variable. And then the file should know how to do it.
Then you know that the variable names you want are the same as those dimension names.
Yes, I see your point. Oops. Yeah, I see. Mm-hmm. I see what you mean. But the thing is that I don't care how the variables are being named.
Right, but if you try to read a file which...
So if the dimensions are called long lat, and the variables are called longitude latitude, everything here will work. I just have to say here longitude latitude.
I know, but this is like, this program is something that you're invoking from some other program, so you don't want to have to change it every time you change your...
Yes, but if you give me a file that has change the longitudes and latitudes, I only change the way I invoke my program.
Well, I mean, let's say you're plotting model versus observations, and the observational data file has dimensions called longitude and latitude instead of mon and lat. So
okay.
How do you deal with that?
I create an object for the measurements. I read the data like this, that I don't care how the variables are being called. Then the longs and lats for the measurements, I use longitude, and that's it. Unless I still don't understand your question.
I probably don't understand exactly.
I mean, the way you name the dimensions, and you say long equals 144, this is not used here. I don't care. I just go in the, when I get the data for the data, for the variable I've read, I just say, I don't care about the dimensions, just give me everything. And then I figure out the dimensions by the size of the array I got. So when you read, when you use getVar in Fortran, you don't care about the dimensions, you just say, get me this variable, the whole. And then you can check the size of the array you got in return. Okay. We're done with that. So, I'm going to show you this program here, the plot ij. And remember that it only has a prerequisite to give some data, nothing else. And then the rest of it can figure it out unless you provide something extra. And this something extra, I have built it over the years, well, not many years. I have it there working, and every time I need to do something different, instead of creating a new plot, a new file that does that different, I just introduce one extra keyword that is able to handle an exceptional treatment of the plot. So I just change things. So if I, instead of, one day I wanted to have titles, one day I wanted to have units. Oh yeah, I didn't show you the units. So yeah, the way the units appear here. So you can, if you don't set the units, this will not be there, or you can just change the code and move the units to the left if you want. And instead of creating another plot, a copy of the plot ij and saving the plot the C here, you can just say units left, for example, and then you put there it. It depends on you, and then, okay. Now, plot ij. At the beginning, it has some, it compiles some things that it's needed. FSC color and color, we saw it last time. It's the thing that picks the, you say red and it picks the red color. Color bar is something that will create the color bar. Get area like geomb, I'm sure you know what this is. And create color table creates a different color table in case I want to have something that is not already available on IDL. So I'm just able to create it. Index find is looking into an array and finds the closest, the index number of a value I'm searching for. So if I have the latitudes from minus 90 to plus 90, and I want to find which index number is closer to the 37.23, then I use the index find and I say, get me that. Because in IDL it's very easy to use to find the index of an exact match, but not the index of the closest match. So, well, it's not really that trick. It's a couple of lines, but it's not provided by default. And then this thing is called stands for distribution. So if you can use it for saying from 0 to 7, I want 23 equally distributed numbers, and then it gives you that. And now this is the plot ij, and all the possible plots today. All the plots, I hope you can see the red, but it's identical with the white. So don't worry if you don't see it. So you can create longitude latitudes, file name, file type. The only thing supported right now is EPS. Title, units, the thickness of the lines, the thickness of the characters, whether you need to overplot some hatching for, let's say, whether there is something statistically significant or not. Levels, you can customize the levels instead of taking from minimum to maximum. You can customize that. You can customize the amount of levels you have, the format of the levels you will see in the plot. So down here it is E.1 and then maybe 9E.1 is the foreground. So you can customize it here. Limit center is what the thing I showed you with the white space around. Around 0 is to have the blue to red color bar. Bottom white is to have the color bar, whichever you pick, but the very, very first one will be white. I don't remember what this is. High res is to plot the countries in high resolution. Countries. This is how you can define an alternate color for the continents. So you, instead of having them transparent, you can say the continents will be gray. So everything will be gray except the oceans. And this is whether you want the extra statistics at the bottom or not. By default, it's enabled. So you can say this equals zero, and then you don't have them. Stations is just to put some extra dots. Number of levels you want, whether you want the scale to be in log, and then whether you want to override the file. But I don't want to go into the options. This list is always increasing, just because you might need something extra to do. I just want you to see remember this plot very well. And because, as I told you last time, IDL is doing one at a time things. And that is why you have to know properly in which order you will do things. So if you do first, for example, the plotting, and then you overlay the contours, then if the contours are black inside, you will only see the ocean. If you first overlay the contours and then you plot, then the contours will be below your plot and you will see it like this. So it's really important to know which thing will overlay the other. So if you go here and you first plot the dot and then you plot the map will be above of the dot. And it depends what you want to do, but I guess that this is the way you want it to look like. So there is some manipulation at the beginning that I'm going to skip. And this is how you set some default values in any subroutine. At first, there is this keyword set parameter. This is a very delicate IDL thing that you have to know. It is the keyword set against n elements. This counts the number of elements that whatever you gave here has. The keyword set checks whether this is anything but zero. So if you call this plot by saying title equals something, this something is not zero, the number zero. So keyword set says true. So when it says true, this whole thing in the parentheses is false, so this is not happening. If you set the title, yes?
Is zero equivalent to a null space?
Zero is what?
Is zero equivalent to a null space? Suppose you set the title equal to just like quote, quote. Would that be the same as setting equal to zero?
I'm not sure about that. I think this is considered a zero, but I'm not really sure. Yes. If you say quote, quote, it is considered a zero. But if you say quote, space, quote, then it's not. Yes. Good point, thanks. So, in case you want to put the number zero in the title, when you say title equals zero, you go here, and this says false. False times false is true, so it goes and does that. It is very, very sensitive, but it is very powerful as well. So if you really want to have, what you want to check is whether there is a value, any value, then you have to go through n elements. So you say here, n elements title. So if you give the number zero is one element, if you give the empty string with no space, quote, quote, it's something. But if you don't give absolutely anything, then this is false, because n elements is zero. You didn't give anything. And the reason why this is extremely powerful is that you can control the way you call it, the way you call the routines. So you can say, for example, So if you say, for example, in IDL, plot ij title equals title, then, and you call it like this, okay? So in the program that has this line, if you do not set the title, then it will pass nothing. If you set the title to anything, it will pass something. So you can control the behavior of the plot ij thing by doing something like this dynamically. Or you can say that, or maybe this is in, this line is into another big program that also has a keyword set title thing. So instead of having it there, you can say title equals keyword set title. And this will return 1, 2, or 0. So if you do it, yes, let's do this better. So if, let's say you have a keyword set TT. So if you have a program that is calling plot ij like this, what happens is that if TT is defined, everything is fine, this is defined, and then it goes, well, you can't say it like this exactly, but anyway, title is a bad example, but let's do it like this. Yeah, let's do it properly. Okay, let's use this. Oops, wraps. So let's say that we have a function here, this function here, and it says plot ij around 0 equals keyword set. So I call the plot ij, I set the keyword around 0, and I say make it equal to this. So if TT is defined someplace before, return 1. If TT is not defined, return 0. That way, around 0 will always be defined when calling plot ij. Always. So if you call, if you check in here for the around 0, which is someplace below, with the keyword set, when this is not set, it returns 0, and then it goes here and finds 0, so it says no, it's not set, and does the default action. If you use here an element, this zero value that will be returned here is legitimate, so this number, this here will say yes, it's set and it is zero. So there are very different reasons why you can use keyword set or an element from one time to the other. And I know it's complicated, but you will find it very convenient to use it. So I'm going to skip some default calculations that I'm doing here, like I just read whatever I got in the input and calculate the delta longitude, delta latitude, I calculate the latitudes. If the keyword set latitudes is not defined, then I read the dimensions of this, I read the dimensions of the data to plot, I create some latitudes to be used later. Otherwise, I just say, otherwise I just calculate them based on what the model gave, what the code gave. So I'm going to skip several things here. And go to the plotting directly. Is it better like this? Okay. So, remember that everything in the plotting of IDL is layers. So if you want to have any lines in your plot, first you have to put the contour behind, the colored contour, and then overlay the lines. So at first, with the contour, we create this interpolated figure. And it needs the values of z, which is practically the number in the two-dimensional space that we are going to plot, the numbers of the x-axis, the numbers of the y-axis. So this is the data, this is the longs, this is the lats. and you can set the range on the x and y axis. You can set the tick points. You can set the tick names, whether it will write 90, 60, 30, or something else. So in my case, okay, so for example here, I have said that it will not be just numbers, it will be 90 north, 60 north, 30 north, equator, blah, blah, blah. And same thing here down. And this is being done by x tick name. And then you can set the length of the ticks, you can set the number of them, you can set the minor and major axis, style. This is something very strange in IDL. Style can take values of 0, 1, 2, 4, 8, 16. And this means something specific. Anything in between is a unique addition of some others, and there is no way to have an ambiguous combination. It can only be certain combination for a given number, and this means the style should be the combination of all these, which are the additions. And the styles mean whether to plot the x-axis, whether to plot the y-axis, whether to plot both the bottom x and the top x-axis, whether the axis has to have strict limits or some more tentative limits to some nice round numbers. It's whether the numbers, the axis should not exist at all. Things like this you can control by the style. And of course, I don't remember the number. What the numbers mean? You can. I always look at them in the manual. So the title, the thickness of the characters. No. Yeah, this is the thickness of the lines. Character thickness, this is the colors that have to be used, the number of levels, where the plot will be positioned in the page, and color and background. Okay, and this, several of these things here apply also to the plot, not only to the contour. I don't know how deep you want me to go into plotting this thing. The color bar requires also its own program to be created. It's a different entity, it's not... And then, if you remember from last time, I was using X, Y, out, S to create the legend. This is the way I use to create the units, to put the units. You know, this little unit just above the legend, above the color bar to the right. So I just say, put it here, this is the position, it will be unit, it will be the value of units, the character will be that thing, the color will be black, align it to the right, and this is normal units. Now for the map, in order to create the map, you just create, first you create a grid, and you say the center of the grid will be zero, the in longitude, zero in latitude. The difference between the grids will be 60 in longitude, 30 in latitude. No label. Align it to the center. Yeah, that's about it. Other than that, the line style. This, wherever you see style, you always have to think of this 1, 2, 4, 8, 16 thing. The thicknesses will be that big. For the continents, more or less the same thing. Okay, here's how I use it. Exactly what I said, told you before. Remember, this is the plot IJ that you can use to call, to have the countries. So when I say slash countries, when I call it, I say set countries to one. So it comes here and says, if this is set, set it also here. And this is how I control it with the controls keyboard set. If zero was also a valid number, I should have used here an element, not keyboard set. So it really depends whether you want zero or the blank string to be used.
Stations.
Yeah, for the stations that I put a dot and then a name next to it. Okay, there is also an object here, forget about it for a minute. You have to create, the circle is not one of the default IDL symbols. So you have to create it. So you create what I do here is I just have an object with some constants, and one of them is a circle, and it just has the 16 points in an XY axis that define a circle. And this gives, so you create the circle here, I say it will be filled, and the color will be red, and then plot it here, and then write something next to it.
How lost are you? How much lost are you?
Are you okay? I know I'm moving fast, but there is no way to cover everything. I just wanted to give you information on how things happen, but you can see that if you just want some default plots, they are ready, I can just share them with you. So, okay, I wanted to say something here now. Okay, here is the format that I'm using as well, but I just have it saved someplace as a string. So you can create this format dynamically depending on whatever you want. Okay. How's everything? Questions? Nothing?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, come on. There has to be something. Can you speak louder? This is noisy.
Have you made procedures to handle other kinds of plots, like magnitude heights, or just in an arbitrary contour plot without any geography to it?
You mean like the irregular grids or something?
No, just you want to make a contour plot of something which is not geographically distributed.
In that case, if you provide the longs and the lats with.
No,
and
just let's say that the x and y
is something completely different.
Not longitude and latitude.
Yes.
Anything.
With this plot, with this function, you can create, you can say longitudes equals to whatever this x-axis is, temperature, and the lat can be anything else, and then it will make the plot. It doesn't really care whether these are really longitude and latitude, they just have to be in an incremental order, but it will put the globe on it. So I can easily put a flag slash no map, and then it will skip plotting that thing. Yeah, that is extremely easy to happen. So I can even show you how this happens. So you have to go here anywhere, it doesn't matter, and you say no map equals no map. And then you go here and you say if keyword set no map.
Can you say again why you're using keyword set rather than?
In this place here, it doesn't matter, because the no map will be a flag of 1 or 0.
Uh-huh.
So no, it does matter. If I say, I can use keyword set here, and the difference will be that in case you say at the beginning, if you call plot IJ without saying slash no map, but instead saying no map equals 0,
mm-hmm.
then the n elements will think no map equals 1.
Mm-hmm.
But keyword set will say no map equals 0.
Uh-huh.
So it depends so if number 0 really means something, you must use n elements. If number 0 doesn't mean something, you can use either of the two, but it depends how you are planning to call the function.
Yeah.
Here. So you have this. Okay, you set the nomap keyword in the call. You set the part that plots the continents inside an if. And then if you go to this one, this here, and you say, in the context first of all, and you say here, nomap. So if you want to suppress something for some reason, you can just do it. And then, of course, you have to handle this axis not to have this behavior. But it's just a matter of keywords. And you don't have to really say to put different flags for everything. You can, instead of calling this no map, you can call